All right, welcome back. This is the Notes on the American Revolution. We finished up last time. We looked at Lexington and Concord, the opening shots, and the Continental Congress, and Declaration of Independence, and now we're going to progress into the actual fighting. So let's get underway. Like we started off last time, the Second Continental Congress, appointed George Washington to be the commander of the Continental Army, and Washington is going to refuse a salary to do this. It's kind of falling in line with his own patriotism. When he started out, he had about 14,000 troops, which isn't bad, considering, but you would expect there to be a lot more. America has a very large population of people. America is split at this time, and it's split into thirds. One third is what you would call a loyalist, one third is what you call a patriot, and one third are people that just don't care. So you got people that side with England, Britain, and just don't care. All right. On top of that, the soldiers that he actually had were all militia, and they are horrible, horrible soldiers. They fight very well if they can run and hide, but they don't fight well if they're having to stare down the British. They also don't have any good supplies. There's no uniforms. They're using old muskets. Discipline is non-existent, and there's little food. So one of the first things Washington's going to do when he actually takes command is he's going to fix all this, and he does a pretty good job. All right. Opening battles in the wars like is were the battles of Lexington and Concord, which we looked at, where the British went to burn a militia supply depot. They faced off against the militia. The shot heard around the world happened. The war had begun. But when they got there, the depot was relieved. Everything was gone. And on the march back, thousands of militia showed up and they started firing on them from the wood line. Another early situation that's going to happen is that the colonists are going to capture Fort Ticonderoga. And one of the interesting players in this is actually going to be Benedict Arnold, who we'll talk about later. But essentially, this capturing is really just because the colonists showed up with way, way more troops than the British actually had at the fort. So they basically captured the fort simply by just showing up. Which brings us to the Battle of Bunker Hill. British General William Howe was located in Boston, and they had this fear that they were going to be sieged. So he knew that he had to attack the hills, and this is something you would have saw in the simulation. So that's essentially what they're going to do. They're going to cross the bay, and they're going to start walking up. Actually, it's Breed's Hill, even though the battle is called the Battle of Bunker Hill. It takes place on Breed's Hill. But Howe is going to march wave after wave after wave against the Colonials. Now, at the top of the hill, you have militia, yes, but they're dug in. They're behind trenches, so they feel a little bit more safe. As they're marching along, you have General Prescott for the Patriots who's going to yell out, "Don't fire until you see the whites of their eyes." And this is so he can hold that militia fire until it will be a very, very accurate firing and they will get the kill. And one of the early engagements in the war is actually going to happen at New York. And this is going to be General Washington trying to hold out and protect against the British. Independence is declared on July 4, 1776, and the battle is moved to New York and New Jersey accordingly. The Battle of Long Island is going to take place July 1776, and the British troops are going to bring in Hessians, which are these German mercenaries. The Patriots and the colonists really didn't like them. They thought they were the kind of people that were going to like pillage and rape and plunder the area. The British are going to take New York City. Washington is going to retreat. Now, this is a blunder for Washington. He leaves his entire flank open, and the British take control of this, and they exploit him, and he learns a very valuable lesson here, which is protect the flank. His strategic withdrawal is very smart maneuvering to get out of New York, essentially, but it's he's actually going to end up having to leave 28,000 troops as they're trying to cross the river to get away. These 28,000 are not going to make it, and they're going to be captured, and Washington has to watch this. Now, even though the Patriots had picked up a little, key victories at Lexington and Concord and at Bunker Hill, so to speak, they had been getting it handed to them. It wasn't that good overall. They tried to attack Canada and they were driven out. New York and New Jersey was lost, so morale was very low. Washington needed a victory to keep the war going, essentially, because people were starting to reject the war. He's got about 2,400 men. And his plan calls for an attack at a much smaller British position, a much smaller British army. And to do this, he has to cross the Delaware River, which was frozen over at the time. It's very early in the morning that we wee hours of the morning around Christmas time, and he's going to attack the Hessian soldiers. He's going to capture 918 and kill 30. And then Washington's going to bed for the night, but General Cornwallis, a British general, is going to be moving in on him. So Washington is going to actually leave his place of encampment, but leave the fires burning. So Cornwallis thinks in the night that Washington is still there. When he wakes up the next morning, Washington's gone. And as he's gone and Cornwallis is stuck in the other area, Washington moves up to Princeton and, with a much larger army, kills about 200 British and drives the British out of the area as well. Then he escapes back across the river. You can imagine this is huge for morale and sentiment in the colonies. They had a long string of losses, and then all of a sudden, boom, two crucial victories in a very short amount of time. It looks really good in the newspapers. And here's an iconic photo of Washington crossing the icy Delaware in his ship, the American flag in the background, and the men rowing and pushing chunks of ice out of the way. Okay, and this brings us to the important Battle of Saratoga. Saratoga took place in New York in September 1777, and it's a pretty important battle as far as the American Revolution goes, because Saratoga is listed as a turning point, and we're going to reference back to this a couple of times. For starters, Saratoga represents a time when a big, formidable American military force was able to fight and to stop the British without massive special circumstances. So you had regulars meeting regulars and them doing a good job. So it showed a turning point in American military strategy. Another thing to look at is that this brings the French into the war on our side. All right. The major players in this are Horatio Gates and John Burgoyne. Burgoyne was trying to crush the American army. Gates had a formidable position on the highs of Brumies Heights, which kind of controlled the Hudson River Valley, leading off into New York and certain other points. Burgoyne needs these heights, and Burgoyne's pressing hard. The problem is Burgoyne's not getting any reinforcements. He's undersupplied, and the British army is getting pretty worn down, which makes him prime for defeat. Even though Gates and Burgoyne are the ones in charge, your major players, the significant people, is Benedict Arnold and Daniel Morgan. Now, Morgan represents this frontiersman ideology, and that's the people that he actually leads and command, and he commands some militia units that are making use of the American rifle. And it's going to prove a pivotal moment when they actually take out a British commander that was bringing on this new defiance, a new spirit. He brought new life into the British defense. So him going down was a shock to the British. And then you also have Benedict Arnold, who leads a miraculous counterassault over the British redoubt and the defenses on the last day, turning the British line and pretty much forcing the inevitable capture and defeat of that British army. So they do big things for Gates, but it seems like Gates is going to get all most of the credit. On October 17th, Burgoyne is going to surrender. This is a huge surrender for the U.S. You can imagine how it looked in the newspapers and people reading it all across the country. 5,000 British soldiers are going to be captured. Remember, the British, they're the most formidable army in the world, and this happens to them. All right? The French are going to see this victory, which brings us back to the idea of it being a turning point. All right? The French see this victory and they realize, hey, America might be able to win this thing. So they just come out in full force. They sign an alliance with us. Remember the French, they don't get along with the British too well. All right, French and Indian War. Massive amounts of land were taken from them. Doesn't sit well with them. Now, a little bit about the French alliance. Ben Franklin is going to be the ambassador to France, and he is definitely one of the most colorful people in history. He very well adapts himself to the French model of being an ambassador and negotiating terms, and he does a good job of getting the French in on our side. We may go a little bit more in depth in him on class. France is going to come into this war and they're going to help America, and but they're also going to upgrade the war from just a colonial fight to a world war. France is going to start fighting Britain in Europe, which kind of makes America, or the American Revolution, a small war within a big war. Another one of the French ambassadors, at least to the U.S., is going to be the Marquis de Lafayette, who is a very influential figure. He's a French officer. He's going to help train American troops. He's going to be pretty pivotal to Washington. In 1779, he's actually going to go to France to get their army and navy to America quicker. So he really buys into this American ideology and this concept of what freedom and liberty is. And I think that's most played out in Lafayette's case about buying into the American ideology of freedom and liberty. He's really going to buy into this concept of freedom and liberty, which I think is why he is so apt to help America quicker. Lafayette is going to be one of the pivotal members in the French Revolution years later. After the stunning victory that after the victories that Washington had at Trenton and Princeton, he is going to be defeated by General Howe, and he's going to lose the city of Philadelphia. The Continental Congress is going to have to flee. It's a really bad defeat, and he's going to end up taking camp in northeast of Philadelphia at Valley Forge. At Valley Forge, the Colonials, the Patriot Army, they're going to run into some hard times. Washington's going into camp with 10,000 men. He's going to lose 2,000. It's a very harsh winter. But morale is not totally shot. It's very much shot, but not totally shot because of the huge victory at Saratoga. It kind of breathes new life into the army. There's also going to be a horrible smallpox epidemic that's going to go through, and Washington is going to take some amazing measures to try to prevent that from spreading throughout the entire army. And probably the most important figure that's going to be at Valley Forge is the Baron von Steuben. That's a very horrible B, I apologize. And we'll talk about Baron von Steuben in just a minute, and you can see his name not written in cursive. Colonial life in America at the time, as far as being a patriot, being in the army, was interesting as well, and it's worth observation while we're in this down period of Valley Forge. The colonials have to pay for the war somehow. Obviously taxation is a big thing. And enlistments are going to range anywhere from 1 to 3 years, depending on who you serve and where you serve. There's going to be different pay scales by state. The states will tax accordingly, and then the states will pay the soldiers overall. And the morale of these men were often very, very low. So, I mean, it was kind of a bleak situation going into Valley Forge as far as being in the army. I mean, it looks like, unless America gets its act together as far as training troops and supplying troops, equipping troops, and paying them, that things are going to go downhill really quick. And that's when the Baron von Steuben comes in. His name is Friedrich von Steuben, and he comes off to us that he is a Prussian general and very knowledgeable in the matters of European warfare. Come to find out, he was actually a captain, and he wasn't even a baron, but we still like to think of him as so because, he's very, very pivotal at this time. He is going to become what we can refer to as the drill master of Valley Forge. And we'll just leave it at V and F. The drill master of Valley Forge, because he is so pivotal in this time. He comes in and he sees all these problems that are going on with the American military. There's so many different training manuals. The troops are not well trained. They're undisciplined. There's just a horrible thing going on, all in all. So what does he do? He comes in and he teaches Washington's troops how to maneuver, how to stand at attention, and how to use bayonets. Now, bayonets are not used on a large scale. They're a minority of the casualties caused, but bayonets have a huge psychological effect. And Britain had been really demonstrating how the use of a bayonet can really scare you into breaking and running. They had been doing it against the Patriots for the entirety of the war. Because of what he's doing, Washington sees this and he realizes that, Baron von Steuben's got it down and we need to get his services broad spectrum. We need to get it across the army and across the colony. So he makes him Inspector General. And as Inspector General, von Steuben creates what would be the first American military drill book, which is known as the Blue Book. And the Blue Book would become the standard for military training for some time. The troops going into Valley Forge are bleak, they're underpaid, they're undertrained. The war could have very well just ended. One pivotal fight and those troops are done. When they come out, they're hardened, they're trained, and they're ready to go and fight the British. This is fitting back into Washington's idea that what America needs is a large, professionally trained army. Now, a little bit about General Cornwallis, because we're going to see him be a pivotal figure later on. Cornwallis is the leader of the British Army. Not overall leader, but he becomes the leader of mainly the southern campaigns, which we're going to look at in a little bit. He wants to divide the Continental Army, so he has this idea. Let's attack the South. The reason he wants to attack the South is because there's a huge Tory population. All right, and what I mean by Tory is that they are loyalists, and that means they're loyalists to the British Crown. Now, keep in mind America's situation. You had the one third. One third were patriot, one third were loyalists, and one third did not care. So it seems like attacking the South might rally some Tory support. It's going to be successful at first, but he's going to run into some problems. We'll get into that a little bit later. Now, in the North, Washington's still fighting, and things are going better. Henry Clinton is leading the British, who is supposed to later on supply Cornwallis but comes up short. Eventually, they're going to collide in the Battle of Monmouth. Washington actually entices him to come out and fight. There's some interesting things that happen at the Battle of Monmouth. For starters, the Americans are looking like they may break at one point. Washington rides out to the front and rallies inspiration. And because he does that, the Americans, due to that training they received at Valley Forge, don't flee. They form up like they're supposed to into a military order, and they march on the British and they fight. And it's a huge, very well drawn out fight. It looks like something you would have seen in Europe between the British and the French. Two large, massive European style armies duking it out, going for the victory. And when the battle ends, it's a draw. Nobody wins. So what does that mean? Monmouth stands as a symbol of the Northern campaign overall. Washington, all this time, had been trying to get a professional army that can match the British. And because of Monmouth and them fighting to a draw, he does that. He puts an army in the field that fights the most formidable army in the world and matches them. And because this battle is a draw, it represents the entire Northern battle scenario. Now all the Northern battles, the Northern campaign ends in a draw. There is no victor. On a side note, something rather interesting is little Molly Pitcher. Her husband was fighting in the war. She brought water to the soldiers while they were fighting, and her husband is going to be wounded. And just like the patriotic feminine counterpart to the Sons of Liberty, the Daughters of Liberty, who helped with the boycotts, Molly is also going to embody that feminine spirit of independence by helping man cannons. And there she is, right there, tamping around. This artist rendering here actually depicts Molly in the position of the tamp, which is the most dangerous position on the cannon. Now, back in the South, Cornwallis had been doing very well. He had a large battle in South Carolina at a place called Camden, where he nearly annihilated the Southern Army. And at Camden, in command, was Horatio Gates. Horatio Gates being the man that had fought so well, or supposedly fought so well, at Saratoga. He was the hero of Saratoga. Gates rolls into cannon and tries to fight the British blow for blow, British style, and he's using mostly militia, and he is going to get destroyed. Gates is going to ride off thinking that the army's completely broke, but the small detachment of regulars he had were still in the field fighting well, so it looks like Gates abandoned his troops. It's going to bring horrible shame to him. He's going to lose his command. After this, Nathaniel Greene is going to come down to America, and Daniel Morgan, or excuse me, Nathaniel Greene is going to come down. After this, Nathaniel Greene is going to come down to the South, and also Daniel Morgan is going to come down to the South. And you're going to have this situation here where they're trying to oppose the British. And probably one of the most pivotal battles that's going to take place in the South is going to be the Battle of Cowpens. It's a large battle in South Carolina. You have a British cavalry force, not the main army under Cornwallis, but Tarleton, this cavalry force, and he's trying to track down Daniel Morgan. The British highly underestimate the Americans at this battle. Militia are out in front of the American line, and the British know militia are awful soldiers attack. The militia break and run. The British didn't know that all these Continental regulars were on top of the hill waiting for the British to get up to the top. Once they got up to the top, they attacked them, counterattacked. All of a sudden, those militia that broke and run come back into the fight and start firing, and it forces the British to retreat. And they lose a lot of people taken prisoners of war, POWs. You can imagine to the commanding British general in the South, Cornwallis, this is going to make him extremely angry. So he's going to get off in a hot pursuit trying to chase down the Americans and get the prisoners of war back. He actually, at one point, to do this, he is going to burn his supply wagons, which is going to be pivotal later on. because he has to return to the sea for supplies. He's also going to fight another battle at Guilford County Courthouse, where the Americans prompt him into a fight. We'll put CC for County Courthouse. And that fight is going to be fought to, some people say a draw, some people say a slight British victory because Cornwallis is rather brilliant. But that battle reduces his supplies to nothing. So he has to take his men into camp at Yorktown, Virginia, which at the time seemed like a good and formidable place to have your encampment. The British had always controlled the sea. You got the sea to your back, which means you got the British Navy to your back. And Clinton is not far off, who is supposed to send reserves. Very short about some of the battles out west. You are going to see some on the frontier, Illinois and Kentucky, and you're going to see the very famous statesman Patrick Henry and Rogers Clark. These are going to be mostly militia battles, the battles out west, but that's okay because the British are actually going to be using loyalist militia. And if you're feeling like you want to Google something, check out the Battle of Kings Mountain. That happens on the frontier. Keep in mind when we say West, we're talking about like the Appalachians. But Kings Mountain on the frontier land of South Carolina, where you have the over-the-mountain men that come and defeat the British. Little bit about Benedict Arnold before we get to the close of the war. Benedict Arnold is very angry about Saratoga. Remember, he was wounded in the leg, like I told you in class. And he's pretty much a hero of that battle, or he doesn't receive the acclaim that he should have. He's put in charge at West Point, and British spies start to negotiate with him, and they convince him to sell West Point to the British. But this plan is actually going to be foiled, and he's going to end up having to flee to Britain, and he actually ends up in command of a Virginia ca or a force of cavalry. He actually ends up in command of a force of cavalry in Virginia, and he wreaks all kinds of havoc in that state for a long, long time until Cornwallis finally comes into Virginia to Yorktown. Interesting story I told you in class. At one point, he actually captures a patriot, and he asked the patriot at the time did not know that it was Benedict Arnold that was talking to him, but he asked him, "What would you do if you caught Benedict Arnold?" And the patriot told him, "We would cut off the leg that was wounded at Saratoga and bury it with full military honors, and then we would hang the rest of him." So, just kind of giving you the sentiment of what's going on there. I mean, Arnold even has a small monument at Saratoga at Saratoga today for his big stance, his heroic act. If he would not have done this right here and betrayed the cause, it's very, very likely that there would be massive cities named after him today. Bringing us back to the end of the war, Cornwallis has moved his army into the position at Yorktown. This is going to be the final pivotal battle of the war. He is in a fortification. Washington is convinced to roll into the area. Washington is convinced to come to the area by his advisors. Green and Morgan down in the south are actually going to stay in the south wreaking havoc. They're not exactly winning. They're rarely winning at all, but they're wearing on the British, which means that British force cannot come up and face Washington. Washington moves down on Cornwallis. He escapes Clinton in New York, and he corners him. And it just so happens that a French fleet defeated the British Navy in the Chesapeake Bay, which meant that the British did not have the Navy on their back. They couldn't just run away, get on the boats, and go off somewhere else. So they could not escape. They were stuck. And French and American armies started to surround Yorktown. Washington started to siege, which means that he started to dig trenches. And he got closer and closer, kind of like we saw in the Last of the Mohicans, until he could get into a place where he could lob cannons over the top. Now, Cornwallis knows that it's over, and Clinton is not sending him any men. So finally, after 3 weeks, Cornwallis, out of supplies, out of options, surrenders his 8,000 men. He actually claims that he is sick and sends one of his subordinates out to surrender. The subordinate walks up to Lafayette, the French general that's over helping the Americans. Lafayette shuns him, looks away, and points to Washington. And when he walks over to Washington, Washington shuns him and points him to his second in command. Because neither Lafayette will not take the honor of accepting surrender, and Washington will not take the surrender from the subordinate. So, but this is the final battle, October 18th, 1781. The fighting in America symbolically is ceased because of this battle. But the war does not officially end until the Treaty of Paris. Now, peace talks had actually begun in Paris in 1782. The British were fighting practically a world war, remember, a small war within a large war, and they wanted to get the French off their back. Ben Franklin, John Adams, and John Jay are sent to England to negotiate the terms of the treaty. Britain in this treaty recognizes American independence. The treaty is going to be signed in 1783, and U.S. boundaries are going to be set. Pretty much all the area that the colonials controlled in the original 13 colonies, the coastline, is theirs. Okay? All of the area that Britain won from France is now America's as well. Britain will remain in Canada. So we'll put them up here. We got the Brits. They're going to be in Canada, or what we know as Canada today. It's Canada back then as well. As a part of the treaty, it's a part of developments that will happen later on with the treaty and with negotiating with Spain. Florida is going to go from the British back to Spain. And that's the changeover that I was talking about earlier. Now, there's a legacy that's left by this war. One is that it inspires revolutions, particularly the one in France. The Marquis de Lafayette is actually a very pivotal figure in it and drafts the Declaration of the Rights of Man after Thomas Jefferson's Declaration of Independence. An aspect of equality is also going to come out of the war, because remember, you had blacks fighting with whites, so slavery is going to begin to be abolished in the North. When we talk about the Constitution, we're going to look at the struggle to end the slave trade and to some recommendations to get rid of slavery at the time, and so on and so forth. Another legacy is that Native Americans are now in trouble. There is absolutely nothing, there's no British entity in America to stop them from spreading west. And we're going to look at this later on when we talk about manifest destiny. But Americans think that it is providence that they go on and pick up more and more land. And then lastly, a new government is formed, a republic, a government by the people, first under the Articles of Confederation, and then later on under the Constitution, which we will talk about in future lectures. All right. So these are the notes. This is complete. This is done. The notes on the American Revolution is now over. When we get in class, we're going to when we get back in class, we're going to discuss these and review these. Be sure to download the PowerPoints offline and take notes on notes. Save yourself some time. Make life a little bit easier on yourself. Look over these notes, study them, and be ready for the test.